I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. Yes, my praise belongs to you forever.
This is my testimony from death to life. His grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. Lord Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
Together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Yes, our God will finish what He started. Oh,
this is my testimony from death to life. His grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. This is my testimony. Grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, oh I'm alive. This is my testimony, from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony.
Welcome, Grace Community. We're so glad that you guys are here and have come to join us. We have a few announcements today. There's a hello card, there's a QR code on the back of your seats, there's also information in the bulletin if you would like to tell us a little bit more about yourself, if this is the first time that you're here. Also, we have a healing service coming up. So this is going to be on Sunday, September 29th. If you need healing or you know someone that needs healing and would like to join us for the anointing of oil and prayer, please make sure that you invite your friends and family, let the pastor know. Maybe ahead of time, but we will be having that service on the 29th. We also have a This Is Our Culture event. This is where me and Christy Sackett went to Sierra Leone, Africa. They have a fundraising event that they do in Illinois in Springfield. It is going to be at the Crown Plaza in Springfield at 7 p.m. on Friday, November 15th. I am definitely going. I'm trying to get my family to go, as many people to go as possible. I hope the Sacketts are going. We haven't talked about it yet, but I know Christy was wanting to go. They're going to have appetizers and auction items and art available. They're also going to have like a photo gallery of all the orphans, and you're going to get to hear them talk about their story and see their pictures. The missionaries that run the orphan home are going to be there, so you can meet them in person, these people that I went and served with. And then also they're going to have like an interactive fishing boat exhibit that one of the people that I went with, he actually built the boat. And so If you're wanting to be more apart but can't go to Africa, this would be another way that you could do that. If you were interested in just donating and you want me to bring that with me when I go, I can always do that too. We can have a caravan, a parade going to Springfield. Because it's at a hotel and it's at 7 p.m. at night, me and my family will probably stay the night. So if anybody's interested, please ask me if you have any questions. I would love to represent with Grace Community there at the event. Also, Hooves of Hope, September 15th. There's going to be food at 5, singing at 6, and that is going to be at the barn in Potomac. And it looks like the Cagle family is going to be there as a special guest. All right, is that all of our? Nope, men's prayer breakfast. We have that coming up Saturday, September 21st, 8 a.m. to 9:30. You guys want to go and get some good food and some fellowship with some of the other men here at the church. That is a great event to come to. All right, is that everything? Okay, I think that's all of our announcements. We are going to pray for our offering. You guys would like to bow your heads. Dear Lord God, thank you for this day. Thank you for your love and goodness to us. Thank you for bringing each and every one that's here today. Lord God, there are things that are weighing on our minds today. We just pray, Lord God, that you will please just help us to feel your presence. We pray, Lord God, for peace. We pray, Lord God, for guidance. We pray, Lord, that you'll just please open our hearts and our minds to what you have for us today. We thank you for all the blessings that you give us each and every day and for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. We never deserve it, and we are so grateful. Thank you for everything that you do for us each and every moment of this day, the little victories, Lord God. We just thank you for the people that are willing to share their talents. We thank you for the children's church that's going on back there, Lord God. We just pray that you'll please guide us and direct us, and we'll give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
As you stand this morning, we are being called to worship. This morning, you are invited to hear a good word. God sees you right where you are right now. You and I do not escape his notice. Hear this good word. Again, I give you good news. God sees you right where you are right now. You and I do not escape his notice. We invite you to worship with us this morning.
This is a house of worship. This is a place of praise, where every demon trembles, where we proclaim your name. This is a house of healing. Our hearts are full of faith. You have our full attention. You have the final say. Come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. We bring everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. There's resurrection power. Your blood runs through. Your kingdom triumphs over even the coldest grave. Come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. We bring everything to the feet of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles. Come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. We bring everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles.
Time. And it talks about this eternal being. And sometimes we read these stories and we think that this God no longer exists. That this is something of the past.
These are stories passed down from generation to generation, and they were good stories. I'm here to tell you, we serve a God who's alive, who still works miracles. If you don't believe that God still works miracles, look up here. Look up here. I am a miracle. Look at your neighbors around you. There's miracles in this house today. Amen? See, sometimes the enemy wants to silence what God is doing and lead us to believe that, oh, those were the old days. Pastor Chris next week will be talking about the healing power of God. There's healing available. If you need a miracle, cry out right now as we continue to worship. Cry out in the name of Jesus. Father, we believe that you're still on your throne. Father, we believe that at your name, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that you are God, Lord. Come, Holy Spirit. You're welcome in this place.
We sing, come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive. In the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles. We bring everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles.
I still believe you're moving.
I still believe you're moving. I still believe you're speaking. God, I believe you're working all things for good. I fix my eyes on heaven. God, I receive your vision. God, I believe you're working all things for good. I still believe you're moving. I still believe you're speaking. God, in the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles. We bring everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles.
Your promise still stands, waiting.
Great lyrics, great singing. It's good to see the church praying this morning, isn't it? Trusting God. Not an easy thing to do. Trust. I was telling some people this week about that word trust
And I may have mentioned it here a few times. It's sort of, sometimes I forget where I'm preaching at, if I've already preached this before. But that word, trust, usually in our English language, it's got a caveat attached to it, trust but verify. We're not going to have an example, but I know you've been in those youth camps where you'll have those leaning back and see if your peers will catch you or let you drop. Anybody like doing that experiment? No. Trusting God is very much like that. We'd rather be able to see with our own eyes, wouldn't we? But there's a lot of trust on this journey. If you have a Bible this morning, turn to the Gospel of Mark. I have to remember to hold this thing closer to me, even though it feels like I'm shouting at you. That way you can hear me better. Sorry for that. I'm getting better at that, hopefully. Am I getting better at it? Okay, good. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, there are two stories that the church around the world reads this morning. And they might not seem like they fit. But hopefully, you'll see by the end of this service that these two stories are placed right next to each other in Mark for a very specific reason. Mark is my most favorite book of the Bible. For a lot of reasons, many of which I've already told you, so I won't tell you again. But I want you to hear, this is maybe the first time you've heard this story. It's the first time you've heard this story after you've experienced the things you've experienced in your life to this moment. So hear it as if you're hearing it for the first time. Mark 7, 24. Jesus left that place and went into the region of Tyre. He didn't want anyone to know that he had entered a house, but he couldn't hide. In fact, a woman whose young daughter was possessed by an unclean spirit heard about him right away. She came and she fell at his feet. The woman was Greek, Syrophoenician, by birth. She begged Jesus to throw the demon out of her daughter. And he responded, "The children have to be fed first. It isn't right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." But she answered, "Lord, even the dogs under the table take the children's bread, eat the children's crumbs." "Good answer," he said. "Go on home. The demon has already left your daughter." And when she returned to her house, she found the child lying on the bed and the demon gone. After leaving the region of Tyre, Jesus went through Sidon toward the Galilee Sea, through the region of the 10 cities. Some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly speak. And they begged him to place his hand on the man for healing. Jesus took him away from the crowd by himself and put his fingers in the man's ears. Then he spit and touched the man's tongue. Looking into heaven, Jesus sighed deeply and said, here's a hard word, Ephphatha, which means open up. At once his ears opened and his twisted tongue was released, and he began to speak clearly. Jesus gave the people strict orders not to tell anyone, but the more he tried to silence them, the more eagerly they shared the news. People were overcome with wonder, saying, he does everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and gives speech to those who can't speak. You can leave that up for a minute. People were overcome with wonder. Mark's gospel does this a lot. People really loved Jesus, and they loved what he did. And Mark makes sure you know they really, really loved him. And in just a few chapters, because they don't do things the way that he wants to do, they want him to do, you know what they do next, right? They're going to plot to murder him. But they really love him right now, so it's important to keep that in mind. When things are going well, they really love him. This story is about a broken-hearted mother. Has there ever been anyone in here who's a broken-hearted parent because of the suffering a child is going through, has gone through? You can raise your hand if there's anyone ever. Yeah. What Stacy said is true. God sees you in that brokenheartedness. He sees you. And in this place that we find this gospel being written, Tyre, it's about 20 miles journey from where Jesus just was. Has anyone ever hiked 20 miles before? A few of you. Were you forced to do this in the military? No, okay. Some of you just like hiking. 20 miles is a long way. Okay. It's actually, I don't even like going 20 miles to Champaign. I know it's more than that, but I don't even like going there in my car, let alone walking there. It's a long journey. And it's a place where there's a lot of trade, Tyre is. It's actually two places. It's a whole region. It even has an island. But it's a place where much business happens, and a lot of the people in Galilee will take their goods and sell them to Greek non-Jewish people in Tyre. But this broken-hearted mother, she knows she has no business getting close to a Jewish rabbi. She's been around Jewish people enough to know that they don't really want to be around her either. But she is broken-hearted. And she wonders, maybe, just maybe, all the things she's tried for her child, if maybe this one, this guy, can offer her some relief. And so she tells Jesus the problem, chapter 7, verse 25. Read it to you again. A woman's daughter was possessed by an unclean spirit. Now, we don't really know what that was or what it is. But we know she really needs this thing to be solved. And in verse 26, she begs Jesus to throw the demon out of her daughter, to heal her daughter. Again, we don't really know what's going on, but she's desperate. She admits that she doesn't have what it takes to bring relief to her daughter. And she wonders, maybe Jesus, maybe you do. And a lot of us, when we read what happens next, we wonder why Jesus is mean to her. In case you didn't know, it probably, and don't use this as a license to be mean, okay? It's probably not a sin to be mean. This is good news, because some of you, I'm not going to say it. It probably is not a sin to be mean. Remember what sin is: a willful violation against a known law of God. If God comes to you through the Holy Spirit and says to you, you're being a little too mean, lay it off. Then if you do it. Because I don't know about you, but the Snickers commercials are real. If I don't eat, I turn into something else. And so do you. Right? We get cranky. And Jesus, I want you to remember, 20-mile journey. Okay? His humanness, I want you to really lean in on this. Jesus is not like so godly that he forgets how to feel. He feels tired. And you can see right at the beginning, he's trying to escape notice. He's trying to sneak off away from the people and get some relief here. 20-mile hike. His body is tired. You ever been tired? And his human, very much humanness, comes out, and it does seem a little harsh. And Mark is making sure everybody knows about the first century here, even without him maybe being aware of it. Verse 27, the children are fed first, is very much a first century idea. Scarcity was a real thing. Like actually running out of food. Mom and dad would work to make sure the kids had enough to eat, because they're going to carry on the family business. They're going to care for me when I'm old. I need them to be healthy. Scarcity. The word is hard for us in this part of the northern hemisphere. We don't have a lot of food scarcity. We have good food scarcity, but, you know, Culver's is coming. That'll help this end of town a little. That's a joke. Scarcity. And Jesus, he's sort of talking about scarcity here. I'm here for the Jewish people. First, I got to take care of the people who've been following God for the longest time. Maybe not doing it well, but at least trying to follow God for the longest time. And what's really funny is when you think about dogs under a table, Jewish people really don't like dogs because they're dirty. They would always stay out of their house, not in their house. But Greek people, we're pretty sure, even in the first century, they would have had dogs in the house. And this story proves that to be true. And the dog is there because Roombas didn't exist yet. They help clean up the mess, run off the run off the rodents and make sure there's no food for the rodents in the first place. And we don't want to overlook how Jesus treats this woman too quickly, because we probably need to be challenged by it a little bit. When you are worn out and tired, how do you treat the people around you? Matters. And in this story for Mark, Gentile, a woman who's not Jewish, how do we treat today in 2024 people who aren't like us? People from other racial groups. Poor people. Are they welcome in our churches, in our circles, in our friendship circles? And this is a challenging one. Are the people who are in the most need getting the most resources in our churches, in our families? Are the people in our communities, are the people who have the most needs getting the most help? Or like what this story says, I think it might be a little convicting to say, are the people who need the most help getting the scraps, what's left over? I don't like how that reads for me. Many churches are like Grace in the world. Multi-congregational. Did you know Grace is a multi-congregational church? You have two churches inside of one. Actually, you might have three, but let's just say you have two. What happens on Friday night is one. What happens on Sunday is one. So it might be a challenge directly lifted from the text this morning for us to make sure that we're treating each other as if we're both at the table and that one is not getting the scraps left over from the other. That hurts a little bit, but it's there. I can't help but see it, so I got to say it. It's a challenge. Who do you think should be at the table and gets to eat with the adults, and who's relegated to the Thanksgiving children's table? You ever had to go sit at the little Fisher Price picnic table when you were 14? And you're going, wait a minute, I grew up. I'm not eight anymore. This story challenges us. This woman, I wish they would have given us her name. This Greek woman is a challenge to Jesus. And I'm going to give you something about Jesus that you don't like. I want you to remember, I am a Christian. They stopped burning people at the stake about 200 years ago. And I am afraid of fire. But you're not going to like what I'm going to say next about Jesus. Or maybe you will like it, because it'll give you some hope. This passage reminds us all on how to lose an argument, because Jesus lost this argument with this woman. Didn't he? She outwitted him. And Jesus, in this passage, shows you and I something wonderful. How do we who follow Jesus, do what Jesus does, lose an argument? When Jesus recognizes that the woman's argument is stronger than his own, what does he do? He grants her petition. I want you to really change your mind about something. When you think about prayer, some of us think it's already been decided. Why even bother praying? I want you to think about prayer just a little bit differently. If you would, just for a moment. You can let it go after this, but what if it's possible for you and for me to actually change Jesus' mind about what he was going to do because of how we argue with him, which, by the way, is simply talking. You ever have to tell that to your spouse? I'm only talking. I'm not arguing. What if it's actually what happens when we pray? That we change God's mind about what he's going to do. Jesus is fully human and fully God right here in this story. Proof that you can't light me on fire today, church. Proof right there. He changed his mind for this woman. And he'll do the same for you and for me. I'm convinced of it. Many of us don't have nearly so much graciousness when we are faced with an argument better than ours. Doors will slam. You'll run away. The words that come out of your mouth aren't PG. Even when we know the other person is right, we may try to justify ourselves rather than agree and get on with the business. Here's the thing that you didn't know about Jesus. He repents in this story. I know that might rub you wrong, because you think of repent next to sin. Okay? Yeah, I didn't say he sinned. He's without sin. Again, nice try. No fire for me today. Jesus repents. I looked up this word in this really fancy dictionary that I had on my wish list for about 15 years, and one day last year, I got tired of having it on my wish list, and I spent the $200 and bought it. So now you get a benefit from the $200. Early in the Greek language, this word repent means nothing to do with sin, though we added it later, especially in our evangelical circles around the 16th century. Metanoia is the word. That word for metamorphosis is in there, to change. Now, I know you know what that word means because you all love butterflies, right? Who loves butterflies? And you don't like what they look like before they're butterflies. You like it when they're butterflies, when they're beautiful. They change their direction. They change their opinion. Change one's mind. That's what repent means. It also means to change one's behavior. So Jesus realizes, I'm being mean to this woman. I need to stop it. And he repents. And he changes his behavior. Isn't that cool? Now remember, Jesus, fully God, fully human, here in the story, I believe he's the same way right now. That's why prayer matters. God, I want you to change the circumstance that I'm in. I want you to heal. I want you to make right. I want you to change me. Jesus proves to us in this story that he'll never turn anyone away who comes to him and needs help. That, I could stop preaching right there, is the best news ever. He will never, ever, ever turn anyone away who comes to him looking for help. The question for us in 2024 is, are we who follow Christ working to make a church where that's also true, where we'll never, ever turn anyone away who comes and needs our help? God help us. So this morning, it's a question for you and for me. And I have to ask it because it might be that you think God doesn't see you, doesn't care. Are you bringing your need to Jesus? I have to ask that question because I think some of us get so discouraged by the circumstance that we have, we don't think there's actually any hope. And we stop asking him for his help. And maybe you're just trying to escape notice, like Jesus is trying to escape notice. You're tired. It's been a long week. You just wanted to come to church and get home and maybe watch some football before you take a nap. You want to rest after a long journey. You might be trying to escape notice in this very room. Verse 31, told you there's two stories here. Let's see why. After leaving the region of Tyre, Jesus went through Sidon toward the Galilee Sea, through the region of the 10 cities, more Gentile cities there. Some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly speak, and they begged him to place his hand on the man for healing. And Jesus took him away from the crowd by himself. And he does more than place his hand on him. It's kind of weird what he does next. He put his fingers in the man's ears. Then he spit and touched the man's tongue. Looking into heaven, Jesus sighed deeply and said, "Ephphatha," which means open up. And at once his ears opened, his twisted tongue was released, and he began to speak clearly. Miracles are not magic or a promise that God will protect us, those who believe in him, from illness. Mark tells us in this story and how he tells how this healing happened, that miracles are God's power at work. And there's something else going on in this gospel. I just want to draw it out. Hearing and speaking are really big in the Gospel of Mark. Really big. The Syrophoenician woman, the Greek woman, was so skilled in how she spoke that Jesus heals her daughter. See how that worked? Those two stories right next to each other. And then you have Jesus' disciples in the Gospel of Mark, who, even though it seems like they can see just fine and hear just fine, not like this man who needed a healing, they seem to, these disciples, and maybe you can identify with them, maybe. They seem to, even though God is showing them miracles right in front of them, throughout the gospel, they have more difficulty than ever understanding Jesus and what he actually is telling them to do. The disciples, Mark is lining up these two stories next to each other on purpose. The disciples need to be healed like this man needs to be healed, so they can really hear what Jesus is saying to them. The ones who have ears are not hearing. And the ones who aren't hearing are being made to hear. You see how that works in the story? So this morning, I'll ask again. You have a need. Something's going on in your life. Are you bringing that to Jesus in your prayer? Or are you just trying to escape notice? Do we see the needs of others and offer them what Jesus would have us offer them? That's a challenge for the church, isn't it? Somebody here had Fortnite hoodie on this morning. And I was going to tell them, I hope you're in the service. I don't see them right now. Are they? If they are, raise their hand. They may have snuck out. Does anyone know what Fortnite is? Oh, yeah, some of you. Now, I wasn't going to name the video game by name because if my mom's watching, she won't be happy that I play first-person shooter games with my daughter. Sorry, Mom. No, really, she probably is watching, so sorry, Mom. But there's a strategy in that game that I think we have in the church. Almost done. Well, I should say a strategy that I have in that game when I'm playing with Bailey. Instead of confronting other people in the game, which would mean to go and kill them in this game, I run away and hide until time runs out and I'm victorious. This is what I do in the game. It's how I play. I literally like, okay, how do I run? And they're like, this is how you shoot. I don't need to shoot. I just need to run. And run fast. Instead of confronting others and trying to get better at the game, you know what I do in Fortnite? I go try to find a hole to crawl in and hide until the time runs out. Church, we can't do that here on the earth with our duty to care for others. Some of us do. We just try to go through unnoticed. That's what that word escaping notice is up there for. We try not to make too many people mad at us. Try to lay low and wait for heaven. You see what we'll miss if we do that along the way? God wants us to know that he sees us. So you might think you're hiding. He sees you. Even those hard days. We can do this. If we ask God for help, he'll grant us our requests. We might have needs that we don't even bring to Jesus because we don't want to be a bother to him. And we wait for the time to run out on the day, and we choose not to get close to Jesus and not close to anyone else either. So this morning, they're going to come up and we're going to sing our last song. That last story where the person is healed of their hearing. Maybe this morning, you need to be healed of your hard hearing. Maybe this morning, the only thing you need to do is pray right where you're going to stand. You can come forward if you want. Jesus isn't just wanting you to capture some of the crumbs that fall off the table. He's inviting you to the full meal. He doesn't want you and I to try to escape notice anymore. These altars are great places to pray, and you can come on the right over here if you want. Someone will join and pray with you, and you can come on the left and we'll give you time to sit with Jesus. But that's the invitation. If you're unsatisfied in your relationship with God, and you're unsatisfied with the people that you share life with, take that to Jesus. Let him offer you a different way, a better way. He knows what you need. He's waiting for you to ask him. He's ready to give it. Just ask. Tell him your problem. Give him the plea. And watch what happens. Let's sing together.
great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of
If you hold out your hands for me as you get ready to leave this place, the Spirit goes with you. Recognize as you begin this new week, the Lord, His very Spirit is with you, keeping you, protecting you. Recognize today, the Lord sees you right where you are. His face is shining on you, and He is so ready to be gracious to you. When you call on His name, the Lord lifts up His face and turns to you and to me, ready, willing, and able to grant His perfect peace. May you go in the name of Jesus. Amen. Have a good week.